distinguished participants, officials, colleagues. I would like to congratulate organizers for showing us at the beginning this historical material. It makes my work, my keynote speech a little bit easier now because the mood is good, the convention is there, and we have this seen how it was born and what is the context of the convention. It is an honor and pleasure for me to be here and to have opportunity to present my views, which are related to the importance of the convention, United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea, as well as the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, and to have an opportunity to share with you the important anniversary of 25 years of the convention in force. I am also very glad that two colleagues of mine, distinguished professors, Rudiger Wolfram, former president of the Tribunal, and Professor Helmut Türk are here with us, and they will probably contribute a lot to what I am going to say and to inform about their views on this important convention. At the outset, I would like also to say that I am very happy to be here because after 54 years, in the mid-60s, I was deputy head of Polish delegation to International Control Commission for Vietnam. And together with my colleagues, we were trying to help Vietnamese leaders and officials to bring peace to this country in that terrible war where Vietnamese people were fighting for the freedom and unity. And this was successful years later, but we try together work for the benefit of Vietnamese nation. I'm very pleased that after half a century, I see this country developing, people happier, young people are having perspectives, and I think it's very, very encouraging that your efforts were successful, and the country is united, and we can celebrate 25th anniversary together. Today's speeches, especially the Deputy Minister's speech and other official speeches at the beginning of this conference, gave us information about Vietnamese position on many important issues concerning also law of the sea. And it makes my work easier because I share these views, and also easier because I can concentrate practically only on some important aspects of legal nature outside politics. The views which I present here are of my own. It doesn't represent any other official position of the Tribunal. I would like to divide my presentation today into two parts. The first part will be devoted to the importance of international, of United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea, and the second part will be devoted to the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea. The first part, The United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea of 1982, as we have heard here, entered into force on 16 November 1994, that's almost exactly 25 years ago. It was a very comprehensive regime created by that convention, and that convention contributed to order in the world, to bring order in the world's oceans and seas, establishing rules governing all uses of the oceans and the seas and their resources. Now it is a global, recognized and globally recognized treaty dealing with all important matters relating to the law of the sea. During one quarter of the century, it contributed a lot to the strengthening of peace, security, cooperation, and friendly relations among nations. I think it would be advisable, though it is known thing, to recall some regulations of the convention and on this basis to see how important the convention is with regard to the oceans, rights to the oceans and the seas. The convention envisages that coastal states exercise sovereignty over the territorial sea, which have been, that they have the right to establish it, its breadth up to 12 nautical miles. And the foreign vessels can overfly, have an innocent passage through that sea. Ships and aircraft of all countries are allowed to transit passage through straits and for the international navigation as well. Coastal states have sovereign rights in the 200 nautical miles exclusive economic zone. With respect to natural resources and certain economic activities and exercise as well, jurisdiction over maritime science research and environmental protection. All other states have freedom of navigation and overflight in their sea as well as freedom of laying submarine cables, pipelines there. Coastal states have also sovereign rights over continental shelf for exploring and exploiting in that shelf up to the at least 200 nautical miles from the seashore. All states enjoy the traditional freedom of navigation, overflight, scientific research, and fishing on the high seas. The limits of territorial sea, an exclusive economic zone, and continental shelf of islands are determined in accordance with applicability to land territory. But rocks, which could not sustain human habitation or economic life of their own, would have no exclusive economic zone or continental shelf. States bordering enclosed or semi-enclosed seas are expected to cooperate in managing living resources, environmental and research policies and activities. landlocked countries have the right to access to and from the sea and enjoy freedom of transit through territory of transit states. States are bound to prevent and control marine pollution and are liable for damage caused by violation of their international obligations and to combat each pollution. States are bound to promote the development and transfer of marine technology. Disputes can be submitted to the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, established under the Convention, to International Court of Justice, or the arbitration. Conciliation is also available, and in certain circumstances, submission to it would be compulsory. The Tribunal's seabed chamber has exclusive jurisdiction over deep seabed mining disputes. From this enumerated general, but not exhaustively enumerated, fundamental decisions incorporated into the Law of the Sea Convention, while not completely exhaustive, I would like out of those only draw attention of distinguished representatives here, distinguished participants, on two issues. The first one is the issue of a situation in exclusive economic zone. In this economic zone, states, coastal states have right to exploit and regulate fisheries, construct artificial islands and installations. The zone for other economic purposes, the use zone for other economic purposes, as well as generate energy from such activity like sea waters energy. With regard to seabed beyond territorial waters, every coastal state has exclusive rights to oil, gas, and other resources in the seabed up to 200 nautical miles. From the baseline of its exclusive economic zone, or to the edge of the continental shelf, whichever is furthest. When the territorial waters, economic exclusive zones, or continental shelf on neighboring countries overlap, the boundary line should be drawn by agreement to achieve an agreeable solution. When the countries have been unable to reach agreement by negotiation, its boundary shall be determined by the third party, namely the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, that like boundary between India and Bangladesh, or International Court of Justice, like the boundary between Bahrain and Qatar, or by arbitration, like boundary between France, England, and United Kingdom. Dear participant, ladies and gentlemen, the second issue in this part concerning United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea I would like to devote to the question of settlement of disputes. According to the convention, state parties shall settle their disputes between them concerning the interpretation or application of the convention by peaceful means according to Article 2 of the United Nations Convention on the United Nations Charter. The convention does not envisage jurisdiction to the tribunal for the law of the sea over the land territorial disputes, including questions of sovereignty over islands or other elevated land features in the seas. A court or arbitral having jurisdiction under the convention shall apply provisions of the convention and rules of international law normally. Under the convention, under the law, international law, states cannot be subject to dispute settlement without their consent. But the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea is a unique one because it contains provisions which provide also for compulsory legally binding dispute solution mechanism for interpretation or application of a convention set out in part 15, section 2 of the convention. By accepting this provision of the convention, states agreed for compulsory process by virtue of becoming parties to the convention. The compulsory process can go forward even without participation of a party to the dispute. Article 7, paragraph 4 of the convention provides that all parties fails if a party fails to appoint an arbitrator, one is selected by the president of the United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea. Annex 7, Article 9 provides that if the party does not appear or defend the case, the other party may request that the tribunal continues for proceedings and make its award. Failure of the party to appear shall not constitute a bar to the proceedings, and if a party does not appear, the court or tribunal must satisfy itself not only that it has jurisdiction over the dispute, but that the claim is well-founded in law and fact. It should be remembered that according to Article 296 of the Convention, any decision rendered by the court or tribunal having jurisdiction under Section 1, Part 15 of the Convention shall be final and shall be complied with by all the parties to the dispute. Such decision should have no binding force between the parties, except between the parties. Such decision shall have no binding force there, except between the parties and in respect to the particular case. The mechanism of solving disputes was elaborated by negotiators to the convention who decided to include to it an avoidance device. To, counters those states who try to avoid disputes. Or settlement of dispute by judicial process. It is very important provision of the convention. A very important use, very important instrument of defending legitimate interests of state in spite of unwillingness of their partners. It was proven by the 2016 award on the South China Sea arbitration, tribunal's ruling of that arbitration. Arbitration for interpretation, 11 provisions of the convention, and it was dealing with issues those issues dividing the conflicting parties in the area of South China Sea. The tribunal appointed under Annex 7 of the convention, which was dealing with this case, had to clarify, among others, two important issues. Namely, the question concerning Chinese claims to historic rights, and second question related to the status of land features in the area of the South China Sea. On the China's claims concerning historic rights, after examining the history of convention, the tribunal noted that the final text of the convention gives other states only a limited right to access fisheries in the exclusive zone of other states and had no rights to petroleum or other mineral resources there. The tribunal also concluded that the convention comprehensively allocates rights to marine areas and that protection of those rights to resources were considered but not accepted in that convention. The tribunal found that China claims to historic rights to restore resources in the South China Sea was incompatible with detailed allocations of rights and marine zones in the convention and concluded to some extent China had historic rights to resources in the waters of South China Sea, but such rights were extinguished by entry into force of the convention and were therefore incompatible with the exclusive economic zones provided by the convention. The tribunal also noted that also China's navigators and fishermen, as well as those of other states, had historically made use of the land features in the South China Sea, but there was no evidence that China had historically exercised exclusive control over those areas and resources or prevented other states from exploiting resources in that sea. The tribunal also noted that historic navigation and fishing by China in the waters of China's South China Sea represented exercise only of high seas freedoms rather than historic rights. Accordingly, it concluded that between Philippines and China, not with other countries, but between Philippines and China, there was no legal basis for China to claim historic rights to resources or other sovereign rights or jurisdiction with respect in the maritime in the respect to maritime areas of the South China Sea, encompassed by so-called nine dash lines. The tribunal concluded that China's claims are contrary to convention and without a lawful effect, to the extent that they are exceeding to annex 7 arbitration as according to Article 227. So this question concerning the provisions related to the question problem of the historic rights in the South China Sea of China, they are extinguishing by the convention. The second topic which I would like to deal with is related to the activity of the Tribunal for the Law of the Sea. The Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, as we have learned also from this introductory remarks today, I think it's very important to notice how far this tribunal can go. The tribunal is a relatively new court. The tribunal is having its jurisdiction based on very detailed descriptions in the Convention of the Law of the Sea. But this is not the only international body which was related to the solving disputes between states concerning interpretation and application of the convention, because there are two or three other bodies like the tribunal in The Hague, International Court of Justice in The Hague, or Arbitral Tribunal or the Special Tribunal of Annex 8, which can be chosen by the states for the purpose of solving their disputes. But the tribunal, as I said, is an active body now. Over 23 years of its activity, 28 cases have been submitted to the tribunal. It is relatively more than any other international judicial body has received in early years of operation. The subject of those cases are wide-ranging, from arrest and detention of ships and crew to maritime boundary delimitations, from obligation and the liability of flag states in respect to unreported fishing, to conservation of living resources, and the protection and preservation of the marine environment, and from immunity of warships to responsibility and obligation of state with respect to activities to the area beyond national jurisdiction. It is important to note that over recent years, the tribunal has been dealing better to receive cases on the merits and request for better opinions. For example, since 2009, the 5 contentious cases and 2 requests for advisory opinions have been submitted to the tribunal. Before that year, only 2 contentious cases have been submitted. This probably because over time, the tribunal has built up its recognition, reputation, and credibility to the efficient judicial, for as an official judicial institution executing its duties. It is interesting in this context that parties to a dispute often agree to transfer to the tribunal the dispute that has been submitted or contemplated to be submitted to the arbitral tribunals. And they are transmitted to the tribunal in Hamburg. The trend is started to be continued since the Saiga case too, and the dispute concerning the delimitation of boundary in Bay of Bengal. In the recent dispute concerning the delimitation of the marine boundary between Mauritius and Maldives in the Indian Ocean as well. It was to mention that parties have started to use the special chambers of the tribunal envisaged by Article 15, Paragraph 2, Annex 6 of the Convention. Such chambers may be formed by the tribunal for dealing with a particular dispute submitted to it by the parties. The composition of such chamber is determined by the tribunal with the approval of the parties. The special chamber are first composed to deal with the case concerning conservation and sustainable exploitation of swordfish stocks between Chile and European Union. It was formed again in the case concerning the limitation of maritime boundary to the Atlantic Ocean between Ghana and Côte d'Ivoire, as well as the recent case between Mauritius and Maldives. Chambers are composed of 3 to 7 judges selected from the members of the tribunal and 2 judges ad hoc selected by the parties to the dispute from outside tribunal. A special chamber has an advantage over a arbitral tribunal in terms of facilities, costs, and time saving. Speaking about the role of tribunal, it should be remembered that access to tribunal is not limited to the states. According to Article 20, Paragraph 2 of the Statute of the tribunal shall be open to entities either other than state parties, in any case expressly provided for in Part 11, or in any case submitted pursuant to any other agreement concerning jurisdiction of the tribunal, which is accepted by all parties to the case. It makes the tribunal open to wider range of parties. Such wider possibility can have important implication for future activities of the tribunal. Also, seabed authority shall be open to any, to not only state parties, but according to Part 11, Section 2, the Convention to Authority, Enterprise, State Enterprise, Natural or Judicial Persons. Ladies and gentlemen, when exercising when the tribunal is exercising its functions or advisory jurisdiction, it often considers other questions too. It it encounters from time to time with legal issues that they are requiring clarification. Sometimes these issues relate to new development international law of the sea. Such substantial situation came up in one of the earliest judgments in Saiga case. Then the tribunal in 1997 clarified the meaning of the term ship or vessel under the convention. It concluded as that case that I quote, the convention considers a ship as a unit as regards to the obligations of state of select state with respect to ship and the right of a flag state to seek reparation for loss or damage caused to the ship. End of quotation. It had also the ship, everything on it, and every person involved or interested in its operations are treated as the entity linked to the flag state, and that nationalities of those persons are not relevant. In a more recent case, the Virginia G case in 2014, the tribunal had to interpret the convention as it applies to bunkering and regulations within the exclusive economic zone with these procedures. Economic zone of coastal state. Bunkering is a practice of selling fuel and transferring it from ship to ship. And is at the sea, transferring from ship to ship at the sea. And is an active activity that is not expressly dealt with in the convention. The tribunal came to the conclusion that, and I quote, the regulation by a coastal state of bunkering on foreign vessels fishing in its exclusive zone is among the measures which a coastal state may take in its exclusive economic zone. Also, since a significant number of cases considered by the tribunal have been related to the arrest and detention of vessels and their crews, and this has frequently involved use of force, the tribunal has found it necessary in these decisions to highlight the importance of humanitarian consideration and respect for human rights. It has stated in several of its judgments that states are required to fulfill their obligations under international law, in particular human rights law, and that consideration of the process of law must be applied in all cases. The tribunal has also emphasized that the use of force must be avoided so far as possible, and where the force is unavoidable, it must not go beyond what is reasonable and necessary in these circumstances. Considerations of humanity must apply in the law of the sea as they do in other areas of international law. The tribunal has also bringing new ground when in first international is the first international body in Bay of Bengal case, it embarked upon a delimitation of the continental shelf beyond 200 nautical miles. In so doing, it provided important clarification regarding key issue arising to this context, such as meaning of natural prolongation, or are the relationship or about the relationship between functions of the tribunal and the commission of the limits of continental shelf. In that case, tribunal stated that it, and I quote, it is difficult to accept that natural prolongation constitutes separate and independent criteria a coastal state must satisfy in order to be entitled to continental shelf 200 nautical miles. In an advisory opinion, the request for sub-regional fisheries commission of West Africa, the tribunal elaborated on legal regime applicable to combating illegal, unreported, and unregulated fishing, so-called IUU fishing activities, a practice that contributes heavily to the depletion of fish stock worldwide and endangers the survival of local communities depending on them. I hope that the clarification provided by the tribunal and its opinion will serve as an important, useful tool in helping states to take effective measures against this wrongful practice of illegal fishing. In Virginia G case, the tribunal addressed also question or issue concerning nationality of claims and genuine link. The tribunal has also contributed to the clarification and development of international environmental law. The tribunal has taken a rather broad views of the scope of the marine environment as well as that of the obligation of states to protect the marine environment. According to the tribunal, the protection and preservation of marine environment is not confined to part 12 of the convention. The tribunal found, and I quote, the conservation of living resources of the sea is an element in the protection and preservation of marine environment. The tribunal also noted that Article 192 of the convention imposes on all states an obligation to protect and preserve the marine environment, and this obligation and provision applies to all maritime areas, on quotation. The tribunal emphasized the duty of states to cooperate in the protection of marine environment. In MOX planned and land reclamation in and ground straits of Johor case, the tribunal stated that the duty to cooperate is a fundamental principle in the protection of pollution, prevention of the pollution and the marine environment, and part 12 of the convention and other international law included. In the area of clarification and interpretation of convention, the tribunal was enforced many times with the new issues. One of them was very important. It relates to application in Louisa case of 2013 of Article 300 of the convention concerning good faith and abuse of rights, which was involved before the tribunal. In these findings, the tribunal provided important clarification concerning the application of this article by stating, and I quote, that it is apparent from the language of Article 300 of the Convention that Article 300 cannot be invoked on its own. It becomes relevant only when the rights of jurisdiction and freedom recognized in the Convention are exercised in abusive way, end of quotation. Being a key player in the dispute settlement system under the Convention and contributing to interpretation and application of its provisions, as well as clarification and developing many norms of public international law, the Tribunal has consolidated its position. By playing this role, the Tribunal contributes to enhancing the role of law in the oceans and as well as maintaining peace, justice, and progress in international relations. Thank you very much for your attention.